Good morning, everybody. I am truly happy to be with you here in Korea. Your Eminences, dear participants, honorable ambassadors, beloved students, at first glance, it may appear strange for the leader of a religious institution concerned with sacred values to be involved in worldly issues. After all, what does preserving the planet have to do with saving the soul? It is commonly assumed that global climate change and the exploitation of nature's resources are matters that concern politicians, scientists, and technocrats. They are considered to be the responsibility of interest groups or naturalists. So the preoccupation of the Orthodox Church, and in particular her highest administrative authority, the Ecumenical Patriarchate, with the environmental crisis, will come as a surprise to many people. Yet, there are no two ways of looking at either the world or God. There can be no distinction between concern for human welfare and concern for ecological preservation. At the late 3rd century, St. Anthony of Egypt, the father of monasticism, described nature as a book that teaches us about the beauty of God's creation. My book, he said, is the nature of creation. There I read the works of God. The spiritual collection known as the Philokalia records St. Anthony as saying, creation declares in a loud voice its maker and master. This is how the Orthodox Church perceives the natural environment. There is, as St. Maximus the Confessor claimed in the 7th century, there is a sacramental dimension to creation. The whole world is a cosmic liturgy. St. Maximus adds, creation is a sacred book whose letters are the universal details of creation. What then is the Orthodox vision of the world? As a young child accompanying the priest of our local village to remote chapels on our native island of Imbros in Turkey, the connection of the beautiful mountainside to the splendor of liturgy was abundantly clear. This is because the natural environment provides a panoramic vision of the world. Nature's beauty leads us to a broader view of creation. It is like the wide-angle lens of a camera. It prevents us from using our planet's resources in a narrow-minded or selfish manner. In the Orthodox Church, this broader vision is defined by the Eucharistic and ascetic dimensions of life. These two fundamental concepts, Eucharist and Ascesis, are profoundly theological and spiritual. The implications of the first term are easily appreciated. The word comes from the Greek word Eucharistia, Eucharistia, or thanksgiving, the same term used for the sacrament of the divine liturgy. In calling for a Eucharistic spirit, the Orthodox Church reminds us that the world is not our private property, but a precious treasure or divine gift. And the proper response to God's gift is gratitude. The second term that defines our response to God's generosity is askesis, which derives from the Greek word askeo and describes the way we treat creation. The world's resources are offered to us by God, not only to satisfy our needs, but rather to be shared with others. They are not ours to abuse or waste, simply because we have the desire to consume them or the ability to pay for them. The ascetic dimension implies a vocation to respect and protect creation. Through self-restraint and self-control, as well as through frugality and simplicity. In this way, everything is restored to its original vision and purpose, as God intended it from the moment of creation. On the sixth day of creation, God fashioned humankind in his image and likeness. However, most people tend to forget that numerous living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind, were also created on that same day. The close connection between humanity and the rest of creation is a reminder of the intimate relationship that we share as human beings with the rest of creation. There is more that unites us with the earth than separates us from it. This is a lesson of which science and ecology have reminded us in recent decades. The saints of the early Eastern Church also understood this lesson very well. They knew that a person with a pure heart was able to sense the connection with the rest of creation, especially the animal world. And this reality has parallels in both Eastern and Western Christianity. Think about St. Francis of Assisi talking to the sun and the moon, or St. Seraphim of Sarov feeding the bear in the forest. This connection with the rest of creation is not merely emotional, it is profoundly spiritual. It is the same truth expressed by St. Paul in his letter to the Colossians, when he spoke of all things created in Christ. This is why Abba Isaac of Nineveh wrote in the 7th century desert of Syria, "What is a merciful heart? It is a heart which is burning with love for the whole of creation, for human beings, for birds, for beasts, for demons, for all of God's creatures." Now, if all of creation is sacred, then our relationship with the environment is sacramental. The sin of Adam is precisely the refusal to perceive and receive the world as a gift of encounter and communion with God and all of creation. This is why, in his letter to the Romans, St. Paul emphasizes the consequences of sin, stating that from the beginning, the entire creation has been groaning in pain, eagerly awaiting its liberation by the children of God. Dear friends, the environmental crisis that we face reminds us of the cosmic consequences of sin, which are more than just social or spiritual. Indeed, every act of ecological pollution or destruction is an offense against God. Unfortunately, however, we have behaved as if we own creation. Creation care is not primarily an ethical or moral issue. It demands a radical change of our worldview and lifestyle. We are called to repent for the way we regard and treat God's creation. Therefore, the traditional concept of sin must be broadened to include environmental abuse. This is why, almost 20 years ago, we declared that to commit a crime against the natural world is a sin. It was in Santa Barbara, California, that we said this. At the same time, natural creation is inseparable from the identity and the destiny of humanity. Human attitudes and actions toward creation directly reflect human attitudes and behavior toward other people. Ecology is related in both its etymology and meaning to economy. Our global economy is simply outgrowing the capacity of our planet to support it. Moreover, scientists estimate that those most hurt by global warming in the future will be those who can least afford it. Thus, pollution is intimately connected to poverty. Creation care is inevitably related to the parable of the Last Judgment, where the Lord says, "I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink." Concern then for the environment is directly related to concern for social justice and particularly to world hunger. And the church that does not pray and act for a polluted world is a church that refuses to offer food and drink to a suffering humanity. This planet is indeed our home, but it is also the home of every human being, of every animal creature, and of every form of life created by God. We must remember that we are not alone in this world, and our generation is not the only one that needs to survive on this planet. Dear friends, beloved students, we have often said that the crisis that we are facing is not primarily ecological. It is a crisis concerning the way we regard and respect the world. Yet, 2 months ago, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change met here in South Korea and issued a report on the catastrophic damage and immense cost of climate change, encouraging greater restraint in energy waste than we ever imagined. So let us acquire a Eucharistic spirit and an ascetic ethos in our approach to creation care. Let us regard ourselves as responsible for every living creature of God. On September 1st, 2017, the World Day for Protection of the Natural Environment, we issued a common statement with Pope Francis, proclaiming that there can be no sincere and lasting resolution to the ecological crisis unless the response is collective and unless the responsibility is shared. Dear friends, the beautiful forests, rocky sea coasts, and wonderful mountains of your country belong not only to the present generation, but also to future generations. This is why the Korean people have a unique reputation for reducing and recycling, as well as respecting and protecting the environment. I congratulate you. After all, humankind is entitled to a better and brighter world, a world free from degradation and violence, a world of generosity and compassion. It is this selfless love for our children that will show us the path that we must follow into the future. Thank you very much. Thank you.